All right, so joining us, we'll continue. Thank you for that breaking news, Stein.
Thanks, Stein.
We will continue this story, and I'm sure we will continue to cover it into tomorrow. Right now, joining us on the line, he's the only liberal talk show host in the state of Nevada. He always raises hell 2 to 4 p.m. on KDWN. That would be none other than our friend Doug Basham. Doug, thanks for joining us. How are you?
Hey, what's
hey
up,
guys,
Doug?
I'm doing well. My quiver is overflowing with arrows, and I just received my Target the White House and Infect a Republican check from George Soros. So life is good.
That's fantastic. Actually, I think it would be coming from Schumer, though. Schumer's the one that's a big part of this. And by the way, how do you just to start things off on just a real aggressive, quick thing? How do you think that Stephen Miller got the virus while he was after testing negative 5 days in a row while he's at home in isolation? How do you think he gets it on the sixth day? You think there was false negative tests for 5 days straight coming out of the White House administration, Doug?
I think that's quite possible because. See, number one, we're going on the premise or the assumption that this administration has been honest with us when they tell us that everybody is tested every day. When this cover-up is fully exposed, we'll find out that no, and in particular, Donald Trump was not being tested every day. It was just another lie from an administration who has lied to us about this virus since day one.
I agree.
This is just part of it.
Doug, I agree with you. So we've been talking about race relations. We've been talking about Michelle Obama and her statement yesterday, basically calling out Donald Trump as a racist. What do you say to that?
You know, I don't know if Donald Trump in his heart is a racist or he just plays one on TV, but I think the more important issue is racists think he's a racist. Mm. And when he continues to play these racist tropes like the blacks are going to destroy your neighborhood, he is throwing out red meat to them because they are an integral part of his base and he needs their vote.
I will actually agree with you on this, that racists do think that Donald Trump is probably racist. I will concede that to you, Doug.
All right, so Doug, well, that's a win for you, Doug. I don't think JD's ever done that before. He certainly doesn't do that with me.
We need a bell that needs to be rung every time.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
All right, so Doug, here's what I'm going to try.
But keep in mind, actual white supremacists are extremely unintelligent, impressionable people.
I agree. That's what Donald Trump is. Anyway,
no,
so
Donald
Doug, here's what
that.
I would like to do. We have a lot of people on hold that want to talk about this race issue, and I want them to have a conversation with you. If you have a question for Doug Basham or a statement on what we've talked about with race issues, we're taking your calls now at 257-5396. Doug Basham, the only liberal talk show host in the state of Nevada, is joining us as well if you have a question or comment for him. Why don't we start off with Kirk? Kirk, you're up on the Vegas take. What's on your mind?
Hey, what's up, Kirk?
Okay, Kirk was not ready. You have to be ready by your phone. Let's go to Brad. Brad is next up on the Vegas take. Brad, what's up?
Oh, Doug, maybe you can answer this because Brian didn't answer it and called me a liar yesterday when I referred to a video of Biden calling black children roaches. I hope you've seen the video now, Brian. I tweeted it to you at the Vegas take. But Biden actually called him roaches. I'm not saying Trump is innocent of everything he does, but this is a blatant form of
racism. But you would like
to
play whataboutism and paint Joe Biden just as bad when you know deep in your heart he is.
Doug, go ahead. We missed the last thing you said there. Go ahead.
Oh, I said, I don't even know what I said. It was spontaneous.
No, that's all right.
He was talking about whataboutism, Doug. Yeah, you were talking about whataboutism. That was your response.
Yeah.
I made some comment, but you want to play whataboutism to paint Joe Biden as racist as people are accusing Trump of being when you know in your heart he isn't.
Correct.
That
all right,
was my point to the caller.
Gotcha. Okay, let's take some more phone calls, and let's let them get their question or comment in, and then we'll let Doug respond. Let's go to Matt. Matt, you're next on the Vegas take. Matt, you're on with Doug Basham. Go ahead.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
Hey,
good.
What's up, Matt?
Got me fired up this morning.
Good.
I don't know where to start.
Okay.
First of all, I don't think we can take anything that Michelle Obama says as credible. I mean, we all know she's a tranny.
All right, get rid of Matt.
Get
rid of Matt. Doug, I know I speak for you and many others as well. When somebody makes a statement like that, they're just a complete dope. But that's the kind of person that is probably wearing his MAGA hat proud right now. So we're not even going to entertain that. Let's go to Sean.
Wait, so if you think Michelle Obama is a tranny, you're going to wear a MAGA hat?
I think if you think Michelle Obama is a tranny, you're probably a Donald Trump supporter and you're probably an idiot.
Well, clearly she has two children. And from what I
do, we really need to entertain this phone call.
From what I can see, that both those children do look like
JD,
a combination of Michelle Obama and her husband.
Thank you for admitting that, but I don't think we even need to entertain that phone call. Let's go to Sean. Sean is next. You're on with Doug Basham. Sean, what's on your mind?
Hey, what's up, Sean?
Sean, are you there? Okay, Sean, have a nice day. Let's go to Danny. Danny is next on the Vegas Take. Danny, what's going on?
What's up, Danny?
Hey, guys. What's up? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, first of all, I just wanted to say, Brian, you are always interrupting JD, and he's extremely respectful with you. Mm-hmm. Most times.
Okay, so Danny, if you have some criticism for me as a radio host, you can send me a message. I'm not interested on the air.
Okay, I just wanted to make a quick one.
Okay, well, thank you for that. Can you please make a point now for what we're talking about?
Yeah, sure. So somebody brought up earlier about how when Trump was put on the spot, he didn't denounce white supremacy in the debate. I just want to point out that Trump's been being accused of this, I mean, time after time after time again, and he's always denouncing it. So, I mean, I just equate it like, can you imagine if Biden is getting asked daily, is he a predator? Is he, you know, does he sexually harass people, kids? You know, because that's what he always gets accused of.
Okay, so let's go with that, Danny. Let's
too.
Okay, understood, Danny. I understood your comment. Let's go to Doug Basham on that one. Go ahead, Doug. Respond to that.
Well, in all honesty, I didn't hear what he was saying. His voice kept trailing off. But you know, if you can give me a quick recap.
Well, basically, he's saying that, you know, everyone accuses Donald Trump of being a racist. You know, what if everybody accused Joe Biden of being a pedophile or sexually harassing? You know, he was trying to make that analogy. What would you say to that?
Well, I would say, I'm sorry. If you support Donald Trump, you long ago sacrificed the right to play any kind of sexual canard card.
Agree. Agree.
I mean, you also sacrificed the right to play the liar card. I mean, there's just... It's just amazing to me how these people, when there's over 45 people who have accused Donald Trump of some sort of sexual malfeasance, will call up and say things like, well, why aren't you calling Joe Biden a pedophile? Well, A, there's no evidence that he is, and number two, it's a stupid thing to say. And I just cannot get over the depths to which people will sink to defend the indefensible Donald Trump.
Don't disagree with you there, Doug. 702-257-5396. Let's go to Matt. Matt is next on the Vegas Take. Matt, what's on your mind?
Hey, what's up, Matt?
Did we lose Matt as well? Maybe we need to reset the phone lines.
Yeah,
maybe
right.
That'll work.
There's been like four calls lost today.
Just has that effect on people.
Yeah, I think you do, Doug. All right, let's go to Tammy.
I don't mind this style, though. I don't mind this structure.
Let's go
it's
to
all right.
JD doesn't have to debate you anymore, Doug. Let's go to Tammy. Tammy is next on the Vegas Take. Tammy, what's up?
Oh, good morning. I was on earlier when you guys were talking about racism, but I had to run in. And I want to say for all political parties and for everyone, I think all of us have a little bit of racism in us, whether it's against color or what someone does. It's just how we're all raised.
Okay, so let me. Okay, so Doug, I want you to respond to what Tammy said, but first I want to respond. What an idiotic statement. First of all, I was not raised to be racist. I was not raised to look at someone and look at someone based on gender or color and think about them differently. I don't know the way you were raised, Tammy, but it sounds to me like you were raised the wrong way. Not everybody in this country or this world is racist. In fact, there's a lot of people that are the opposite of that. Think of the millions nonviolent protesters out there that want equality for minorities. A lot of these people happen to be white. They're not racist. So, Doug, when you hear somebody like Tammy call in and have this horrible take that everybody has a tad of racism, what would you say to Tammy?
I agree with what you said, Brian. I couldn't say it any better.
All right, fair enough. I took the words right out of your mouth.
Exactly.
Fair enough. All right.
That's exactly right.
That's exactly right. Yes. Thank you, Mr. McCloskey. 702-257-5396.
That's exactly right.
Let's go to Matt. Matt is next on the Vegas Take. Matt, what's going on?
Hey, what's up, Matt?
Did we lose Matt again? Wow. Let's go to Lewis. Lewis is next on the Vegas Take. Lewis, thanks for calling in. What's on your mind, Lewis?
Hey, guys. Well, look, you know, people always say defending the indefensible. No one is defending Donald Trump.
Well, okay? Some people are.
Everybody is defending Donald Trump.
Okay, if that's what you say. Here's the deal, okay?
No one
is defending him. Everyone is just pointing out the left hypocrisy. Everyone, even Donald Trump voters, know that as a person, he's probably not the best person. But you know what?
You think?
If you, as a voter or a person, are looking to a politician, any politician, for morals, decency, and honesty, that says more about you than it does the politician.
All right, Lewis, let's let Doug respond to that. Go ahead, Doug.
What? What? Run that. I can't believe I just heard what I think I just heard. Tell me what he said about honesty.
Well,
I mean, I could not have heard that. Tell me again, Brian. What did he say?
I think he was trying to make the correlation that Donald Trump is an honest person, which I think we're
That's
both
exactly right.
Which we're both laughing at.
No. No.
So, Doug, what do you say to that?
You got
to
give him credit. You know, our 15 cases did go down to zero in a couple of days, so I guess I'm out of line calling him a liar.
I think he's got more than 15 cases in the White House right now, and I heard that.
No kidding. He has more cases in the White House than they do in New Zealand and Taiwan combined.
I don't know if this is true or not, but I heard there were going to be planes and helicopters flying over the White House that are going to be dropping off Clorox. I don't know if that's true or not.
Brian, for 3.5 years, I have said that once Donald Trump leaves the White House, they're going to have to fumigate it. That was kind of tongue-in-cheek. Now it's reality.
Now it's reality, and I heard that the Chinese president is now calling this the White House virus. So I don't know. Yeah, that's what I heard. But, you know, who knows? I want to talk quickly. I want to pivot to the vice presidential debate, if I may. So obviously, Kamala Harris will be on a stage tonight with Mike Pence. I don't think Mike Pence is an extremely intelligent person. I think there's plenty of Republicans out there that are very smart. I just don't agree with their politics. For example, you know, I don't think Marco Rubio's a dumb guy. I think he's a bad guy, but I don't think he's stupid. I don't think Ted Cruz is stupid. I don't think Lindsey Graham is stupid. I think they are much better debaters on a debate stage, or they would be, than Mike Pence. And I think when you have Kamala Harris tonight, who is a lifelong prosecutor, she knows how to debate. She made a Barr look like a complete moron, and she's very good. She's very good debating skills. I think Pence is going to have some problems tonight, Doug. What do you say?
Well, I wouldn't, you know, as much as I hate to praise Mike Pence, I wouldn't count him out. Before he got into politics, he was a right-wing radio host.
He was.
Mike Pence is smooth. The problem is he's going to lie through his teeth like he has for the past 3.5 years.
Yeah.
And Kamala has got to be ready to call him on it because he is going to defend this administration's failures on the coronavirus, and she's got to be ready to knock them down.
That's a fair point. Listen, you're absolutely right. Pence has a career early on before he was as a right-wing talk show host. Let's take some more phone calls at 257-5396. Doug Basham joining us on the line. Let's go to Jeff. Jeff is next on the Vegas Take. Jeff, what's going on?
Hey, what's up, Jeff?
I just want to comment on, I'm not sure how far I am behind, but two of the last three callers, one called up to defend Trump saying everyone's racist.
Right.
Your next one called up to defend Trump saying that every politician lies.
Right.
And I mean, they're pretty much saying right there what Trump is. So
agree.
That was my comment.
No, I'll agree with the second. I do think pretty much every single politician lies, but I don't think that everyone is inherently racist, though. I think that that's a very, very odd thing to say.
First of all, not every politician lies.
Joe Biden has lied numerous times.
I don't know anyone in recorded history that has amassed and accrued a documented searchable database of over 20,000 lies in 3.5 years.
Well, there also hasn't been, you know, three different fact check organizations pretending to be neutral that clearly aren't, that all they do is they spend all day long like Daniel Dale just listening to what the president says.
Right.
And in most cases taking it out of context and saying that it's a lie.
And doing the exact same thing to Joe Biden.
What, Doug, I don't think you heard Doug's question.
Like
JD.
For example,
hold on a second, JD. Doug just asked your question.
I heard what he said. Yeah. No, but doing the exact same thing, like for example, with Joe Biden, when Joe Biden says that he wants to redirect money from the police department to other departments, that is the definition of defunding.
You're not answering Doug's question.
But if you go to Snopes.com, they will say that he doesn't want to defund the police because he didn't verbatim say, I want to defund the police.
Let me repeat.
So factcheck.com, they'll do something like factcheck.org or other fact check organizations. They'll take something Biden says, and if it's not verbatim, they'll say that it's partly true or half false.
JD,
but with Trump, if he doesn't say it to an absolute T, then he's lying.
Okay, so
even if what he's saying is the definition,
Doug, I'm trying to ask JD the question, he's ignoring your question, so I'll try to ask it because JD won't answer it or allow me to ask it, so I'll ask it. What Doug just asked you, you're talking about Daniel Dale, and you were criticizing him. What Doug asked you is, can you give one specific example of an instance where Dale said Trump lied and Trump was actually telling the truth and Dale was lying? Can you give us one example of that?
Off the top of my head, I cannot.
You cannot. All right, Doug, I asked him for you.
Next time you're on the show, I will do that. I will come up with 5, 4, or 5.
Fair enough. 702-257-5396. We have the only liberal talk show host in the state of Nevada.
Was that an IOU?
I think it was. I don't know.
Yeah, sure, that's
fine.
It
was a talk radio IOU.
I think it
was. Well, that's the exact same thing that happened with...
JD.
When we talked about South Korea, I believe, and the cases in South Korea.
Yeah, I'm still waiting for that IOU to be paid.
No, I responded to that in kind. I talked about that the next week.
257-5396. We have Doug Basham on the line. Let's go to Jimmy. Jimmy is next on the Vegas Take. Jimmy, go ahead.
What's up, Jimmy?
Hey, I just read this article on Google. It's Media Cried Wolf, calling every Republican a racist, lost its fight. It said that on CNN... that and MSNBC, more than 1,100 times from Sunday to Tuesday, they use the word racist.
Okay, so what?
Do you think it's being a little overused?
No, I don't, Jimmy. I'll let Doug answer that, though. Jimmy thinks that the word racist is being overused. What would you say to that, Doug?
I think he probably has a point. I don't think it's being overused in the context of Donald Trump and the racist tropes and dog whistles he sends out to his base, or that part of his base that he needs. But I think one thing that's overused, and a lot of people don't understand the meaning of it, is when they say, oh, you're playing the race card. Just because you bring up the topic of race does not equate with playing the race card. When you play the race card, that is when you dishonestly accuse someone else of being a racist. But people use that card anytime you bring up race to either avoid talking about it or to express the true feelings.
So, Doug, coming up next, after you hear the other side of it, we have Hogan Gidley. He is the national press secretary for the Trump campaign. So this is a question I'm going to ask him, but I want to ask you this. Why is it that those in Trump's administration will not tell us? They won't tell us when Donald Trump tested negative. They won't tell us the last time he tested positive. They won't tell us any information. Why is that?
Well, I mean, let's get down to politics 101. Any administration will release information that will either play to their benefit or exonerate them. The reason they're not releasing it is because, like I said, we're in the middle of a cover-up that would make Watergate look like a picnic. This is Watergate, pardon the pun, on steroids.
Mm-hmm.
Dexamethasone, to be precise.
Sure.
Now we're going to find out that Donald Trump wasn't tested every day, that he was positive at the Amy COVID Barrett super spreader, and that he's been lying all along. He was positive at the debate. He was positive in Minneapolis. He was positive the whole week.
That's exactly
so,
right.
So you think that they've literally, because people go to the White House every single day. Like, for example, Dave Portnoy, when he interviewed Donald Trump, he went to the White House and he got tested. So you think that when people, Donald Trump is in touch with people all the time. So why would he not get tested, and why would they not get tested every single day you're assuming that he's only around the Trump administration and his family and his campaign team and people like Chris Christie. That's just not the case. So I think that you're very, very incorrect in that, Doug, because I guess you could make that.
You owe me.
No, and I got you one right now. By the way, here's one. They're saying that Donald Trump said that crime has increased in New York City by 100 to 200%. And factcheck.org says, no, that's misleading. Well, Donald Trump is, when he's talking about crime, he's talking about shootings, and shootings are up 165%, and murder is up about nearly that much in New York.
Shootings,
I get that.
Crime.
Well, that's what I'm saying, is that they take things that he says, and even though he means crime that's actually that people see, that people hear about the news, like when people get killed or when people get shot, and they take it out of context. Well, actually, crime is only up 0.7%.
But
that's an example of what they do to Donald Trump.
To interpret and say, well, what he meant was this. No, they can only go by what he said.
Okay,
and enablers and defenders.
When you have Donald Trump saying that crime is
interpreting it so that it's not so damnable.
I get that. So when you have Donald Trump saying that crime is up by 100 to 250% or 200% in New York City, you have a problem with that. You don't think that he's talking about shootings and murders and killings and the things that have been actually publicized on a national level, because that's what he's talking about. He's not talking about small petty crime. He's talking about major crimes. Obviously.
Well, I think
and it's true. And he's not lying about that.
This is another distraction from Donald Trump. And last time I checked, he was the president of New York.
What'd you say?
He's the president. He was the president. He's the president of New York. He's the president of Nevada. He's the president of Connecticut. He's the president of the United States.
And every single state is sovereign. Every single state makes their own decisions.
So he takes no responsibility?
There's leadership at the local, the federal, the state, and the federal level.
So can I ask you a question?
Donald Trump can't tell the governor of New York what to do.
Let me ask you a question.
Trump can't tell.
Hold on.
Donald Trump can't tell the mayor of New York City what to allow his police officers to do.
Okay, so fair enough.
Donald Trump can't tell the New York City Council.
You got to let me interject now. Okay.
I mean, keep in mind.
You got to let me interject now.
Just hold on, real quick. So the mayor of New York and the New York City Council, back in, I believe it was June, they took all the plain clothed officers off the street. And within a month or two of that, and we had Darren Porsche on, and he confirmed this, crime skyrocketed. That was a decision that affected the murder rate and the shooting rate in New York. But Donald Trump had nothing to do with that decision. So when you say Donald Trump is the president of New York, yes, he is. But he's not the one making those decisions that would increase crime like that.
I will take 5% of the time you took to make my point, which is this. For 8 years, Doug, we heard Republicans blasting Barack Obama for the crime that was taking place in Chicago. You can't have it one way and then have it the other way. I guess Obama is not responsible for the crime in Chicago.
Well, here's the difference.
If I could please finish my statement, please. Thank you. You can't blame Barack Obama for violence in a city like Chicago, but then some of the violence that's taking place, it's not on Donald Trump's watch. Doug, what do you say to that?
I agree.
How can you agree with that?
I like how that one caller was talking about liberal hypocrisy when Republican hypocrisy is in your face so much and so close you can't see it.
Well, the difference is Barack Obama was actually a politician in the state of Illinois, and he had the ability to pass laws.
And Donald Trump was a real estate developer in New York, your point.
My point is real estate developers don't actually make laws. They don't tell the mayor what they don't make decisions. Barack Obama was an important decision maker in Chicago. How can you laugh at that?
Okay, let Doug respond.
My point is Obama was a politician, and Trump was a private citizen. There's a major difference there. Obama was an elected official in Illinois.
Right,
Donald Trump
respond.
Was not an elected official.
Let our guest respond, please. Go ahead, Doug.
Yeah, what I would say is what this all boils down to, irregardless of the 50 states having sovereignty, is that a national or a global pandemic, and in this case a national pandemic, is a national problem. It requires a national response. It requires national leadership. We didn't have that. He schlepped it off into the governor's laps because he couldn't be bothered governing. He never wanted to govern. He just wanted the power, and now we're seeing the results.
I agree.
Why would he govern?
I agree 150%.
He's not a governor. He's the president of the United States.
He is the ultimate governor of this country, and he could have led by example.
Doug,
no one's saying he had to order the governors to do something.
Doug, how long did the impeachment last, and when did it end? When did it start? When did it end?
Well, J.D., you know the answer to that.
I do. You're right. I do. Yeah, February 5th. That's the day that the impeachment ended. Why was the impeachment validated by Alexander Vindman? Why was Alexander Vindman validated by the Mueller report? Where did all of that come from? Where did this idea that Donald Trump is this Russian asset, this lapdog to Vladimir Putin, where did all of that come from?
I'll give you one example, the fact that his son arranged a meeting between Russian lawyers when he was told in an email it was part of the Russian government support for his father's candidacy.
No, it came from Hillary Clinton and a staffer that made up an idea,
JD,
to distract the general public from her emails.
Let's give Doug the last
by turning Donald Trump into a quote-unquote Russian, and this entire situation, this hoax, this Russian hoax that started off with
Democratic hoax.
Well, that's exactly what it is.
Yes,
I can say that with a straight face. But this entire thing that started during Trump's campaign, it literally lasted all the way, and it took us into COVID-19. You had the Mueller report that took 3.5 years. Then you had the call with Vindman in Ukraine that led to the impeachment. The impeachment actually trickled down into COVID-19 because on January 30th, the day that he shut down travel to China, that was 6 days before the impeachment actually ended, Doug. But no one talks about this. No one has those conversations. Doug, Donald Trump
talks about it every day, which is why you are.
Why does left-wing media not talk about it?
Left-wing media? You mean the media that actually reports honest that the right-wing media has been beating into submission for years?
No, this is not. Something that's been beat into submission. This came out from Daniel Radcliffe. This came out yesterday.
Well, now there's a reliable source.
This came out yesterday from Brennan's notes.
He was placed in the position of DNI because he was qualified or because he was a Trump lackey and lemming.
All right, Doug, we got to go, my friend. I appreciate the call, as always. Always enjoy spending some time with you, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah,
so,
thanks, Doug. Enjoyed it.
Sadly, we got to go, my friend.
Thanks, all right, guys. We have.